This video goes over using the substitution method for solving recurrence relations. A previous video goes over where recurrences come from, including the first two examples in this video, and also kind of justifies some of the rounding that we use here. But if you already get that stuff, start here. We start with a really simple example, and for it, we'll mention a few issues that we normally sweep under the carpet to keep things simple. Using those simplifications, we'll analyze the Mergesort recurrence more deeply. Next comes an example that needs a slightly more complex approach using lower order terms. Then we take a quick look at a common pitfall for a stranger looking recurrence. So we start with the recurrence for searching a linked list. The basic technique of the substitution method is to just guess the answer and then try to prove that your guess is correct using induction. In this case, we guess the relation is big O of n. Inductively, we just assume that relation holds for all values smaller than n, and try to prove that that implies the relation holds for t of n, the time of the algorithm. Because n minus 1 is smaller than n, we can use our inductive hypothesis there, simplify, and ask if the result is less than our constant c times n. Because that's what we're trying to prove, that t of n is less than or equal to c times n. We inductively assumed it, and now we need to prove it for the same c. Here, it holds for lots of c values, and we pick one. Let's say c equals 1, and n at least 1. By our definition of big O, we've proven our recurrence is big O of n. To be fair, we did make use of some simplifications here. The first couple have to do with the constants we use. For the base case of the recurrence, we never actually referred to it explicitly. From the thing I proved, we get t of 1 is at most 1, t of 0 is 0, but are they? Well, I'll come back to the t of 0 issue later, but what if t of 1 is some other constant? Similarly, I modified the actual recurrence and assumed that the theta of 1 term was 1. What if it was some other constant? Well, here I'm assuming that we're trying to solve an equation for time. I haven't yet defined what 1 unit of time is anyway. I can ignore these issues by renormalizing my time units. Note, the 1 inside the parentheses doesn't get renormalized. That isn't a time unit number, that's just a number. Also, the Mergesort recurrence we'll see next has a 2 multiplier. You can't renormalize that out of the equation. It's also unitless. But these other changes we make are okay. If you're trying to get a perfect solution to the recurrence, you need the exact base cases. Otherwise, realizing that for fixed size input, our program should take a fixed time, we can define our units in terms of that fixed time for any small sized inputs we want. Also, sometimes we get some math where we need an n-naught, but otherwise we oftentimes just use it to let us ignore some stuff we want to ignore. So again, even if we want to search an empty list with no items, that would take some positive time. We can't get t of 0 is 0 no matter how we renormalize, but we just ignore that and say we don't care about 0. We only care about n values at least 1. We can ignore small values in our big O definition. So next we get to probably the most famous of the recurrences in computer science. We want to prove that it grows no faster than n log n. Just like before, we inductively assume that it's true for smaller values, plug in, knock out some algebra, and ask if that is less than our assumed c n log n. It is. For c equals 1, we've proven the relation is big O of n log n. I won't get to where the guesses came from until the next video, but we should explore what happens if you guess incorrectly. For instance, what if you guess too big, like n squared? Well, it turns out that for any c at all, the relation holds as long as n is at least 2 over c. So in this case, we actually did need to calculate an n-naught value, and we know the relation is true for n larger than that. The smaller c is, the larger n-naught will be. So if you pick the c of only 1 over 100, gives an n-naught of 200 here. We use the n-naught term to assume that n is at least 200, and if n over 2 is less than 200, we use the fact that the program takes a fixed time for a fixed number of values, renormalize to that time as needed, and assume everything holds for our base cases there. Here, because we show it works for any c greater than 0, we've actually proven that t of n is little o of n squared. Well, what happens if we guess too small? This slide is the same as the previous one, except for our function guess, and the proof fails. A failed proof generally doesn't prove anything, but in this case, we can really make some simple changes to our calculations and get a different proof. Again, this is the same slide, except that less than or equal to has been replaced by greater than or equal to, and the definition for big O has been replaced by the definition for little omega. And we see it holds. So if T of n is little omega of n, it grows strictly faster than n, so it can't be big O of n. That shows that the previous proof had to fail, because we were actually trying to prove something that was false. To be complete, I'll include the matching n log n lower bound proof for this recurrence. The proof for big O omega looks just like the one for big O, so I won't go through it step by step. Stepping to another recurrence, we want to prove that this one is linear. We go through our normal steps, make our inductive substitution, and see that our algebra doesn't go through. C drops right out of the equation, the proof fails. So what does a failed proof imply? Does it mean that the recurrence isn't linear? No. Of course, if the recurrence isn't linear, the proof had better fail, but the failed proof doesn't mean the thing I was trying to prove is false. A failed proof means nothing. Even so, I like to interpret it as a deep, meaningful statement about me and my worth as a person. I'm very sad. We could, of course, jump to a bigger function like n squared or n log n, and those will go through easily. But what if we just go a tiny bit bigger? I'll actually try to prove the function is big O of n plus 1, which is the same order growth as big O of n, but it gives us an extra constant to play with. I do my inductive step. The algebra looks very similar to before, but I again fail. Before I was off by 1, now I'm off by 1 plus c. Making the function a tiny bit bigger actually made us miss by a little bit more. But this gives a big hint for how to get the proof to go through. Make the guess a bit smaller. Prove big O of n minus 1. The algebra is the same except for the sign change, and everything goes through nicely for c equals 1, so the function is big O of n minus 1. Well, if it's less than a constant times n minus 1, it's also less than a constant times n. So let's think about that a bit more. The inductive proof for big O of n failed, so did the proof for big O of n plus 1, but the proof for big O of n minus 1 went through just fine. We're actually able to prove a stronger statement because we're using induction, and it allowed us to use a stronger inductive hypothesis. I want to cover one last issue because I think students commonly make mistakes on it. Let's say you run into some weird looking recurrence. I've seen a lot of students break this into two different problems and try to prove some relation on each one where each one looks more normal. You can't do that. You can't just pretend that this problem is two of the problem that you're used to. Instead, just inductively fill in like normal, but there are two inductive cases. Fill in for each, for k equals n over 7 and k equals n over 4 in this case. Each of those is less than n, and you work out the induction like normal. Okay, the next video will talk about the recursion tree, which is one place where these guesses might come from, but of course you could actually just guess. After that, there will be a video or two on the master method, but for now, I'm going to cry myself to sleep in the fetal position.